Check it out now, y'all.
Nano Hub U, online instruction.
If you recall in the last lecture, we defined a model to describe electron states in solids. The name of that model was referred to as the free-electron model for electrons. It's a very simplistic approach, and we're certainly going to discuss its implications in more detail in the coming week or so. But before we do that, I wanted to just spend a lecture on something called the reciprocal lattice. This is an important concept in condensed matter physics. So anytime you have a solid where all the atoms are periodically located in space, the definition of this reciprocal lattice turns out to be a very useful definition. And the sole purpose of this lecture is introduce you to this concept of a reciprocal lattice so that you have some fundamental understanding of what it's all about and what it accomplishes. Now, this lecture will use Euler's theorem extensively, right? And in particular, you have to be convinced that this quantity here, this identity here is true. It just basically says that e raised to the 2 pi times an integer times I is always equal to plus 1. So we'll make use of that fact many times in this lecture, and I just wanted to mention it up front. The motivation for this lecture is to ask how realistic this free electron model is. And what we like to try to do is we like to try to identify shortcomings and see how those shortcomings can be alleviated. And clearly the most glaring shortcoming of the free electron model is this fact that it completely neglects the periodicity of the solid. So if you recall when we discussed the free electron model at the end of the last lecture, we just took electrons and we threw the electrons into a box. The length of the box was a distance L, and the bottom of the box was very flat. So this potential well was flat, and there was no hint of any periodicity, repetitive periodicity of the interaction potential energy in that model. So it's a fair question to ask what new effects emerge as you take this periodicity of the lattice into account. And the answer to that question is this definition of the reciprocal lattice addresses this issue in a very, very nice way. I'll also say that this entire lecture is basically focused on one dimension, and I do that to make the points clear so that you can understand the arguments perhaps a little bit more readily without getting involved in all the vector arithmetic that's required to conduct this discussion in three dimensions. So I did put into the appendix of this lecture some of the definitions that allow you to define a reciprocal lattice vector in three dimensions. Prescription for identification in three dimensions just requires you to do some vector algebra, and that's all laid out in the appendix. But the basic lecture today is going to focus on one dimension to try to make the physical points as clear as possible. So what are the new conditions imposed on any model that attempts to describe, let's say, electron states in a perfectly periodic crystalline solid? Well, there are two issues, right? The crystalline solid, first of all, can be modeled by a collection of atoms in one dimension. So remember, we're focusing on one dimension. We have a collection of atoms in one dimension. These atoms are equally spaced by this distance A. This distance A is referred to as the lattice constant of the solid. And typically, this lattice constant's on the order of 0.2 to 0.3 nanometers. The entire length of the crystal, how long the crystal is going to be represented by this symbol capital L, and capital L is going to be set equal to N, capital N, times this lattice constant A. And L could be millimeters or centimeters because we're trying to describe electron states in single crystalline materials that are macroscopically large. So L is the dimension of the crystalline solid, and N is going to be a rather large number because A is a small number. A is on the order of 3/10 of a nanometer or so. So there are two issues, right, that have to be addressed if you want to discuss this problem in a rational way. The first issue is, how do you model the interaction potential energy that that an electron sees as it moves back and forth in this lattice of one-dimensional atoms? So in particular, we want to expose the role of the lattice constant A in this discussion, and that's going to come in our model of U of X. So that's the first issue that we like to discuss. And the second issue we'd like to discuss is what to do at the ends of the crystal. All right, so if you can imagine, the crystal starts out here at some position x equal to 0, and it ends out here at some position x equal to L. What do we do? How do we handle the boundary conditions at the ends of the crystal? So that's the second issue that this lecture is going to address. So to do the first issue, how do we model the periodicity of this rigid lattice? Well, here what we do is we try to sketch out what the problem is, right? The each atom in the lattice is comprised of a positive ion core. The ion core is going to have a Z protons associated with it. So there's going to be a plus ZE charge located periodically in space, every distance, every lattice constant A. And then associated with this positive ion core, there are going to be quantized electron states that come from solving Schrödinger's equation for the individual atom, when the atom is isolated in space. When you bring this collection of atoms together, the electrostatic Coulomb interaction that's indicated by the solid line here for the isolated atom, that starts to get modified as these atoms get closer to one another. And there's actually a lowering of this electrostatic potential energy in the region between two atoms. This lowering of the electrostatic potential energy, of course, is the main motivation for releasing these highest energy electron states that are predicted by the solving Schrödinger's equation for the individual atom. And so these most weakly bound electron states now get delocalized from the atom cores, and they're free to move around in the lattice. So there are two things that we'd like to accomplish if we want to describe this situation. One thing we'd like to accomplish will our model explicitly have this periodicity associated with it? So in other words, every lattice constant A, will we see the exact same electrostatic potential energy, for instance? And then the second issue, which is a little bit more complicated, is how can we reproduce the exact shape of this interaction potential energy that occurs between the individual atoms? It turns out that's a difficult problem because it's difficult to go in and directly measure this, right, inside of a solid. But our two goals are going to be to resolve these problems, at least in theory, if not in practice. So how do we think about this, right? Well, to me, one of the reasons we spent so much time back in the fourth week of the semester on Fourier series is to basically set up this lecture today, right? If you recall that discussion from lecture 4.03, we said that if you have any function f of x that is periodic in x, right, that function can be represented by a Fourier series. And the arguments of the sines and the cosines in that Fourier series, right, those arguments are related to the repeat distance of this function in x. So for instance, if the repeat distance is designated by L0, then the Fourier series has to contain sines and cosines. and the arguments of those sines and cosines are going to be integers multiplied by this constant 2 pi over L0, right? So this 2 pi over the repeat distance times an integer plays a very important role in the Fourier series that's developed to approximate f of x, right? And of course, how closely you can approximate f of x depends on how many terms in this Fourier series you keep. So if you keep maybe 10 terms or so, you'll start to get a function where these sharp step edges are rounded off, but you'll accurately reproduce the depressions in this function f of x, which are separated one from another by this repeat distance L0. And if you want to do a more accurate job of reproducing this function, you just have to basically keep more terms in this sum. Okay? So, we're going to apply that idea now to use a Fourier series to approximate U of X. And, what we're going to do is we're going to write down, just based on the equation from the previous slide, we're going to write down a Fourier series for U of X. It's going to contain the sine and cosine terms with coefficients that have to be decided. And again, we're going to realize that the arguments of these sines and cosine terms include this 2 pi over A times an integer N. It's just directly analogous to what we discussed when we were thinking about these one-dimensional functions, F of X, back in the fourth week of the semester. Now, it's pretty straightforward to show that this Fourier series that contained both sines and cosines, that can be rewritten to contain an exponential with an imaginary argument. So if you redefine C sub n and D sub n according to what I've written down here, then you can show that this cosine and sine series can be rewritten in this more compact form, where now we have coefficients u that are labeled by these wave vectors g sub n, right? And these wave vectors g sub n are going to be defined in terms of this quantity 2 pi over a times a signed integer. So n can be or g sub n, right? G sub n can be either positive or negative, depending on whether the integer n is a positive or negative number. And this quantity, integer times 2 pi over a, this is what we refer to as the reciprocal lattice vector. And this is what the topic of this lecture is mostly about. So this is a mathematical identity. It takes a few steps for you to prove that with these substitutions, these two forms for the Fourier series are identical. And what this Fourier series is saying is that if we keep enough terms, in principle, we can reproduce the exact shape of the interaction potential energy as a function of position x. And so therefore, we can use this Fourier series for u of x in Schrödinger's equation. And in one dimension, then we would have an equation that looks something like this, right? And of course, what we're interested in is the energy eigenvalues that result now from this more complicated form of Schrödinger's equation. At least it's more complicated than most things that we've seen up to date. Okay? So, what are the advantages of doing this? Well, the first advantage is, and this is probably, maybe it's obvious, but nonetheless it's worth mentioning, the Fourier series expansion of U of X guarantees the translational invariance of U of X. So what do I mean by that? I mean that if we pick any point in the one-dimensional lattice of atoms X, and we transform that point, we just add an integer number of lattice constants A, so we just add MA to X, right? We get to the exact same point in the lattice, we're just displaced down by some distance MA. But if we look around and we could imagine doing local measurements, everything at position X should match everything at position X plus MA. And that just simply means that the interaction potential energy U of X has got to equal the interaction potential energy U of X plus MA, right? Well, you can take wherever X appears in the expansion for U of X, you can replace X by X plus MA, and you end up with an expression like this. And the only way this expression equals this expression is if this quantity E to the IG times MA is equal to unity, and that implies that G, this reciprocal lattice vector G times MA is equal to 2 pi times N, okay? So M again is a displacement vector, MA is a displacement vector, so M is an integer. N is an integer that specifies the different terms in the Fourier expansion of U of X. So by writing U of X in this way, right, this translational invariance of U of X is completely guaranteed. And of course, what that's basically saying is, if you sit at some point X in the lattice where X is any arbitrary position, and then you translate, right, if you move by a distance an integer number of lattice constants MA, you'll end up at the exact same point in the lattice. And if the lattice is perfectly periodic, there's no way you can tell the difference between this point and the original point. And that's what U of X, and that's what this Fourier expansion of U of X guarantees. So the reciprocal lattice in one dimension can be visualized in a very simple way. First of all, let's talk about the real space position of atoms. Right, in real space, the position of atoms is localized at these positions that are separated one from another by a distance a, and so these locations where the atoms are positioned, they're special, right? They're special positions in real space, and they're designated by these offsets precisely equal to a. In the same way, right, if you define a reciprocal space or a wave vector space, or it's often called K-space, there are special values in K-space. And these special values in K-space are defined to be 2 pi times a 2 pi divided by the lattice constant A times a signed integer N. So these reciprocal lattice points in K-space are defined, for instance, as minus 4 pi over a, minus 2 pi over a, 0, 2 pi over a, 4 pi over a, and so on and so forth. And they form special points in K-space, just like the position of atoms in real space defines special points, right? And what you have to recall is that these reciprocal lattice vectors, G sub n, okay, we relabel the reciprocal lattice vectors by the subscript n to indicate which value of which integer has been multiplied by 2 pi over a to get to this particular reciprocal lattice point. These reciprocal lattice vectors are key ingredients in that Fourier series expansion of U of X, and that's something that you have to understand intellectually and believe in, right? It's a fact, and it's something that keeps coming back over and over again if you try to understand electronic states in solids. So that's the main point of this slide, is to try to get you to appreciate the similarities between real space and K-space based on this definition of the reciprocal lattice vector. A completely general way to specify a reciprocal lattice vector is to write this equation down here, which says that E raised to a reciprocal lattice vector G times L, where L is a displacement by a positive number of lattice constants in a solid, right? That product of G times L multiplied by I, that forms the argument of the exponent. When e to the I g sub n l is equal to unity, that defines the reciprocal lattice vectors g sub n. And so it's this definition, this more formal definition, that's used to define reciprocal lattice vectors in three dimensions. And if you want to see that discussion, then I refer you to the appendix. But you often find this definition written down in textbooks, and it follows very simply from the discussion that we've had in the previous few slides. There's another advantage, another unique advantage of these reciprocal lattice vectors, and I want to try to illustrate that by just asking you to think about the wave function for a free electron. Right, the wave function for a free electron is represented as an e to the ikx form, and very often we subscript the wave function psi with the k vector k that appears in the argument of the exponent. So whenever k happens to equal one of these reciprocal lattice vectors, right, then we can rewrite the wave function for a free electron by subscripting the wave function psi with the appropriate argument that appears in the exponent, in the argument of the exponent. So whenever k is equal to a reciprocal lattice vector, then we can write the free electron wave function in this form. And the beauty of writing the wave function using these exponential notations is that you can ask, what is the value of the wave function at x plus l compared to the wave function at x? And so if you just write down the wave function at this position x plus l, where l is again an integer multiple of lattice constants a, that's a translation, right? You'll end up with an expression that looks like this. From the previous slide, we already know that e to the igl is equal to unity, right? So this drops out. And we're then left just back with the original wave function that we had when we were at the position x. And this is just basically saying that the wave function at x happens to equal the wave function at x plus l whenever the argument, whenever the k vector of the free electron wave function happens to be equal to one of these reciprocal lattice vectors. So when k is not equal to g, this does not this translational invariance of psi does not occur, right? You'll see I work it out down here. You find that when you translate the wave function through a distance l, and when k is not equal to g, you just pick up some additional phase factor term that doesn't disappear, right? It's the disappearance due to this e to the igl equal to unity that makes these reciprocal lattice vectors unique. So there's one last topic that we have to cover in this lecture, and that's what to do with the ends of the crystal structure. So we can imagine where we've got a crystal lattice that's comprised of, let's say, n atoms. And the total length of this crystal runs from x equals 0 to, let's say, x equal to l. Right? What do we do about the wave functions at x equal to 0 and the wave functions at x equal to l? Because at those two points, this periodicity disappears, right? It just stops. And so what's customary is to imply a cyclical boundary condition. So it's like imagining that this line of atoms is then bent and twisted onto itself. And what we then insist on is that the wave function at x equals 0 is equal to the wave function at x equals to l, right? And so that just simply means this condition has to be true. The wave function at the end of this linear array of atoms is precisely equal to the wave function at x equal to 0. So this is a boundary condition that we apply. And the implication, right, when you follow through that boundary condition, the result that you get is that the wave vector k that appears in the wave function for a free electron, that wave vector k can no longer have any arbitrary value. It has to have a certain value that's related to the reciprocal lattice vector 2 pi over a times n. N appears in the denominator. N is the total number of atoms in the linear array. And then there's this integer multiplier M that also comes in because, again, we have to insist that this particular term is equal to unity, and that implies that the argument of the exponent is equal to 2 pi times any integer m. So we subscript the allowed wave vectors k by this integer m, and it basically means that only certain wave vectors k will satisfy these cyclical boundary conditions. And that has a rather interesting effect. If you look at allowed k's that satisfy the free electron model, the model that we worked out at the end of the previous lecture, we basically realized that any k value was allowed. Now what we're saying is that there are only certain k values, k sub m allowed, and these allowed k values are separated one from another by this separation 2 pi over Na, where Na is the total length of the one-dimensional lattice. And then on top of this very fine-grained separation between allowed k vectors, every once in a while, one of the allowed k vectors is going to happen to equal the a reciprocal lattice vector G sub n, right? So our k space is now becoming a little bit more interesting. It becomes quantized due to this cyclical boundary condition. And in addition to becoming quantized, we also have these certain wave vectors, which we call reciprocal lattice vectors, that become important. So this sort of introduces in a very general way what a reciprocal lattice is. And it allows you to identify the quantum states that are possible when you solve Schrödinger's equation now, including the periodicity of the lattice and including these cyclical boundary conditions, right? So the wave vectors, the allowed wave vectors k sub m are now going to be the new quantum numbers in our discussion of electron states and solids. And they're going to replace, let's say, the integer quantum numbers that we uncovered when we thought, let's say, just about the hydrogen atom. Recall in the hydrogen atom, we ended up with 4 quantum numbers. Well, those 4 quantum numbers are now going to be represented by these allowed k vectors, k sub m. So that's the main point of the lecture, is to get that point across and to get you to start thinking about reciprocal space. So I'm a few minutes over. I have to stop this lecture. It contains some very important ideas that I hope you have a better understanding of. And what we're going to do now is we're going to start to explore the free electron model in more detail with this background that's been discussed in this lecture. So we'll see you next week, and we'll finish up our discussion of electron states and solids by expanding on a lot of these ideas that we covered in this week of the course.